2 months over a period of 5 years, every 2.5 years they add a month in order to get the solar and lunar calendar back. There's some beautiful poetry of cosmogonic time. This is a very famous poem called Nasadiya Sukta, in which it begins by saying, at first there was neither being nor being, there was neither air nor yet the sky beyond. What was dropping, where was the protection, and a whole bunch of speculations, and even statements like that even the gods came after its emergence, then who can tell where it came from? And then they speculate that maybe who he was in the highest sky knew about it, and then at the end complete, maybe even he does not know. Okay, the idea that the cosmos is this fantastic idea which was born out of nothing and which remained about which nothing can be known simply because there is nobody around to tell you about it. There are 7 verses actually. I have cut down to 4 for shortening, and even out of those 4 I can't sit and read all of them, but it makes really a very beautiful poetic speculations. Who really knows, who does presumes to know and tell? Nasadiya Sukta, if you are not read, you should go and read it. It's really a very beautiful piece of speculative poetry. The third stage astronomy, and there is also another one on Kala which is very nice, which I don't have here. It is there in the notes that I have given. But on Kala there is a very nice speculation. Kala, who is supposed to be the father of everything, then eventually turns into the slave of the human beings. And that entire transition is discussed in that beautiful Rig Vedic speculation. Then the third stage astronomy comes in, which is the astronomy of a civilization. When we talk of civilizations, you obviously begin with Harappan civilizations. What happens in this stage is that by now people have so much wealth that they start worrying about making sure that the wealth remains with them and goes on to their children and so on and so forth. So you get this first idea of astrology coming in. People are now speculating, they want to do things at correct time and please the gods so that the wealth that they've generated passes on to their children and so on. Cosmogonical ideas become more sophisticated, old ideas get re-evaluated, and astronomical mythology becomes more interesting, and all kinds of quarrels happen in the sky. In the absence of knowledge, such activities have a certain respectability, so astrologers were some of the most respected people in this period. That includes old myths are reinterpreted, and some really sophisticated speculations about our place in the universe, etc., come in, and I'll show them to you in the examples. The interesting mixture of religious beliefs, astronomy and architecture begins to emerge, and for the first time you get this combination, which itself is fascinating in its own right. Some basic mathematical astronomy now starts arising because people can actually put in numbers and start calculating the length of the day, various issues about phases of the moon and so on and so forth. Harappan civilization, we all know, fairly sophisticated, 1.5 million square kilometers, orthogonally designed housing, most of them just 5 degrees off the north for reasons we don't understand, beautiful miniatures, very beautifully designed miniatures. These typically tend to be 3 or 4 centimeters in size. I'm not going to talk about any of these aspects except to say that we have found these huge boulders. This is about 45 centimeters by 60 centimeters or so, and the speculation is that they were actually used for astronomical calculation because this kind of copper use have been wires have been found, and the suspicion is that they used to keep a track of it in Mohenjo-daro. Harappa has a beautiful skyline, so you can look at the mountains in the sky to keep a track of the sun. Mohenjo-daro's landscape is completely flat, so they probably use this kind of things to keep track of what they did that. There are other tentacleizing evidences, we are not so sure what they mean. This is one of the most heavily discussed pieces of Harappa. It's a small 3-4 centimeter piece on gold in Harappa, and if you are as biased as I am, you would see about half a dozen constellations in this. You would see Saptarshi over here, you would see Taurus over here, you would see Orion, Gemini, Pisces and Cassiopeia and so on and so forth, but we really don't know whether that is true, and unless we have an idea about what they used to write, we will really not be able to know. But it's interesting that they should have had fairly sophisticated astronomy, but we really have no idea what it looked like. On the other hand, that period would also coincide with Upanishadic period, and there you have something interesting. In Brihadaranyak Upanishad, Yajnavalkya has a discussion with Gargi, okay? And Gargi is one of the few female names in Upanishadic literature. She's a very learned woman, and she has this discussion with Yajnavalkya. And she asks him, what is around the earth? And Yajnavalkya says that the earth is wrapped in water. So she says, what wraps water? She says, water is wrapped in air. So she says, what wraps air? She says, air is wrapped in sky. She says, fine, what wraps the sky? He says the world of Gandharvas wraps the sky. The obvious question is, what about the world of Gandharvas? And that is wrapped in the world of the sun, one of the great Adityas. And the world of the sun is wrapped in the world of the moon. The world of the moon is wrapped in the world of nakshatras. The world of nakshatras is wrapped in the world of devas, Indra, and eventually Prajapati. And when she asks what is the world of Prajapati, and it says Brahman. And when she asks what is the world of Brahman wrapped in, Yajnavalkya eventually loses his temper and tells her to shut up. And you can see that in Upanishad. But it's interesting that except for this planet and moon being reversed, the sequencing is fairly nice. Okay. Today, if we were to write this, we would probably go 1, 2, 3, then we would bring in moon, then we would bring in the planets, then we would bring in the sun, but the rest of the things we would not change. Yugas is a concept that I told you originally rises in Rig Veda and begins with Vedang Jyotish, where it's a 5-year cycle to fit lunar and solar calendar. In this period, it changes. Lagada changes the meaning of Yuga to mean Daivik Varsha, and he goes into various calculations and then he extends it to this millennial period that we know as Yugas today. All those numbers are divisible by 365, and our suspicion is that they were actually a smaller set of numbers, but I'm not going to talk about it. It is in a few hundred BC that all this Daivik Varsha and major 4 Yugas etc. comes in. Then of course there are Mahayugas and all kinds of concepts come in, but the original use of the word yoga in say Yuga is essentially to synchronized solar and lunar calendar, which then changes meaning with time. Trimurti, of course, is now the important 3 gods who control the creation, survival and death of the universe, and their beautiful mythologies and their own Puranas. Then you have an interesting Dashavatar story, where the first avatar is a fish, the second is a tortoise, the third is boar. And then, of course, the rest of them are human. They probably had some kind of a general idea that life probably arises in water, and then through reptiles that it comes on the earth, and that pre-earth also there were other life forms, and that humans are probably a later arrival. There are some conspicuous missing things over here. There are no insects, there are no birds, which I find surprising. But it's interesting that they do seem to have had some idea of cosmogony that seems to have gone into designing the structure of the Dashavatars. The out of the Dashavatars, the first 4 avatars are supposed to come in Satya Yuga, 2 in Treta Yuga. We have had only 1 in Dwapar. Kali Yuga has not done very well. We have had only Buddha, and the last one will come when it is time for all of us to go home. Okay. On the other hand, the another myth that is very well redesigned, interestingly, is the idea of this Rahu and Ketu. In original structure, Rahu and Ketu are one of the Navgrahas, and after the 7 grahas, these 2 are the dark ones who sort of try and block the sun and the moon, and therefore they are called the dark ones, the demons. In subsequent, in Shiva Puran, for example, that at the time of Samudra Manthan, it becomes a mythology of a god a demon who has drunk the Amrut and his head is cut off, and therefore he tries to go and kill sun and moon, and therefore tries to eclipse them and all that. So the mythology changes color. But in Siddhantic period, Rahu and Ketu get redefined as the 2 nodes of the earth-sun line, and if the sun and the moon come there, then you get an eclipse, and Rahu and Ketu positions can be calculated very accurately, and Apte sir can tell you that you can do it with high degree of precision and therefore predict eclipses with very great degree of accuracy by the same idea of Rahu and Ketu, who have now a completely different meaning in the later literature. So you can use it for defining eclipses. Temples are another set of interesting things which we find fascinating. Temples arise in India about 500 BC. It's essentially a Buddhist influence on the Hindu religion. It essentially represents the cosmos in its microcosm. It is specific orientations of entrance windows and sunlight. Architecture in temples have similar natural extensions to megaliths, and I will show you. There are 2 basic types of temples in India, the Nagara and the Dravidian. This is the Dravidian temple, where the place where the god rises actually is the least important of all. The 4 entrances are the most important pieces, and they are invariably assigned north, south, east, west. Nagara style temples, the most important structure is where the god himself resides, and then there are outer halls where people can worship. But it's interesting that these, for example, if you look at Meenakshi Mandir, its entrance, its Gopuram, for example, it looks so beautiful. A typical human would be about half this height. You can imagine what a magnificently tall structure it would be. And if you think about it, it is not very different from the megaliths that were built in 1000 BC, where huge stone structures were set on either side. Now, of course, the civilization is more structured, so instead of a couple of meters, it becomes 30, 40 meters. But it is the outer region that remains important, exactly as in the megaliths. It was the outer region that remained important. Similarly, if you look at the structure of a typical Nagara temple, you have the idea that the cosmos and the universe stays over here, and we are on one periphery of it, essentially worshipping the god who is at the center of this entire architecture. There are also interesting astronomical observations which are fascinating. There is a mention of what is called Saptarshi calendar in Rig Veda, and which says that Saptarshi moves into different nakshatras every 100 years, and that year of depending on which nakshatra Saptarshi is in, that is the period of that is a century that is defined. And any common sense observation will tell you that Saptarshi doesn't move. Saptarshi has seven stars in the sky, they don't move, they remain where they are. And therefore, it is generally assumed that the Saptarshi calendar doesn't really make much sense, simply because the stars don't move in the sky. But if you go back and look at the original definition of Saptarshi calendar, it is in fact quite accurate. In Matsya Puran, it has been defined fairly accurately. And it says you take the first two stars of the Saptarshi, move it to the local pole, and wherever this line meets, this is the nakshatra of Saptarshi. And it's trivial to show that this vector actually moves with time. In 2100 BC, it was in Pushya. Today it is in Pura Falguni, and so on and so forth. And when Parikshit took over the reins of Ayodhya after Mahabharata, it pointed to Magha, and Saptarshi century was Magha century, and that you can date to 1200 BC. So various astronomical observations can be used to date some of these observations. One thing that we found some time back was that Brihat Samhita mentions a very peculiar event of Rohini nakshatra, seeing Mars or Saturn in Rohini Shakta, Rohini nakshatra, and that didn't happen after 5200 BC, and it is related to a very major flooding and they use a nice word, they use pralay as the word, and the last great pralay coinciding with the major rise in the sea level comes to around 5000 BC. So we have had a suspicion that maybe there was some memory of an old event that exists there. But more classical dates, Yajurved comes to about 2300 BC, Yajurved Vedang Jyotish comes to 1300 BC. This has been done by Shastri from Vedang Jyotish. Period of Lagada, where he defined the polar latitude of Sravishta, comes to 1340 BC. Mahabharat from the Saptarshi calendar comes to about 1200 BC. And there are other literature which comes to Parashara Samhita, for example, comes to about 1100 and 1300 BC, because it defines various things. So you can actually use this precession to date various documents based on astronomical information. Astronomy and navigation at sea at this stage is an important one, and if you go and ask the Gujarat coast, even Maharashtra coast fishermen about how do they navigate themselves, they'll tell you that they don't follow the normal constellations at all. For each port in the world, or each port that they go to, they have a diagram like this, where each angle, they define a specific design. So if they have to go from here to Oman, they will essentially say that you follow this pattern at night for 3 days, and after 3 days, you follow this pattern at night, and you reach wherever you want to reach. Okay? The entire navigation is done by the stars, and these are the kind of star charts they used even, what I have here is from 1300 BC, but even 1300 AD, but the suspicion is that they are much older than that. The oldest printed version you can get is about 1300 AD. They also define the constellations in their own way. For example, this goes in Taurus in conventional astronomy, but they define this constellation completely. They define constellations in their own way because they want to navigate in their old way. And this you can date back to Chola period in 900 AD when they tried to redesign the night sky for you. There's also an interesting mix of philosophy and mathematics that comes in at this point and which I've put in here not because it's part of continuity, but because I find it very fascinating. So you'll have to bear with me for that as an diversion to the story. But there are various kinds of infinities. Indians, for some reason, have loved infinities from the beginning. For example, the Greeks, on the other hand, hated infinities from the beginning. Whenever they got infinity, they had to cut it down to something smaller, while Indians love infinity. And there are varieties of infinities in Indian literature. Okay? It is not just mathematical infinity. There are several kinds of infinities, infinity of numbers. Even in Vedic literature itself, you can go to 10 raised to 17 and beyond. And various number, the number of cows that you can get is infinite, infinite, infinite. And if you convert those infinities, it comes to 10 raised to 17. There was no way anybody would have had 10 raised to 17 cows, but the number exists. Okay. Time, on the other hand, has fascinating various issues. I am not so sure you can read it from here. Brahman created, for example, universe out of pure thought. And then yugas and mahayugas and other cycles come in, which runs into hundreds of millions of years. There is another series of ideas where there is a loop of illusion. Time illusions are many. There is a famous story where Narad and Indra, I think, are going somewhere, and Narad is sent to pick up some water, and he goes somewhere, and then he falls in love with a girl, and the whole story is there, how he suffers through his entire life, and then eventually when he dies, he comes back to Brahma and says, oh, you took 5 minutes to get me a glass of water. Okay, the whole period that fellow's life was just a 5 minute period, because that looping of time, and interesting thing is that it doesn't violate causality, it is always later. Whenever there is a time loop, the time loop comes back later. Space has various kinds of infinities. It's interesting that in the early literature, the idea of infinity in the sky didn't exist. Infinity in space exists more in the two-dimensional geometry of the Earth's surface. There are also infinities and infinities and infinitesimals of the smaller than the smallest and the larger than the largest. But the infinity of skies comes, in fact, much later in the Indian literature. On the other hand, later literature has this infinity of space extended way beyond what we would think reasonable, and I'll show you an example of that. It was there even in that discussion with Gargi. Duration of life is another infinity. We all get reborn until we are pious enough to be absorbed in the God's will, but otherwise you have to have an infinite number of life and time loops. Number of gods, of course, are way beyond infinite. We have all variety of gods. Meditation is supposed to provide your knowledge and mind, which is also supposed to be infinitely deep, and they particularly are conscious of infinity. Brahman himself is essentially an abstract infinity. We use this concept of Purnat, Purnamidam and stuff like that, where completeness merges into completeness in things. The only exception to the rule is this causality of gods. Indra gives rise to Brahma, Brahma gives rise to Indra, each rises from each other's belly and things like that. It is only in these early gods that you have this intermixing of time, which violates causality, but otherwise they don't violate causality. Then the astronomy of the fourth stage, I'm not going to talk much about it, especially in the presence of Apteshav, I look rather silly talking about it. Beyond this level, astronomy becomes more sophisticated, the culture becomes more specialized, it translates into various educational programs and things like that, and I'll show you the syllabus of one such course. And the common feature is that by now, state patronage becomes important. By now, astronomy becomes state supported, and even today it remains state supported. Depending on the capability of development and various interactions with other civilizations, astronomy then takes a major different form, and so after that, astronomy is essentially what we see today. Siddhantic astronomy is a phase at which you would identify it in India. 500 AD, Aryabhat starts with this Aryabhatiya, which you have here. In that sense, it's an important starting phase of civilization astronomy in India. The preoccupation of Aryabhatiya and beyond that is essentially calculation-based astronomy rather than observational astronomy, and they develop fairly beautiful, complex mathematical equations to understand and calculate astronomical movement. This includes concepts in trigonometry, various functions, and fairly large steps in calculus. At this stage, the exact mathematical equations of movement of moon, sun, planet, Rahu, Ketu, eclipses, etc., everything becomes clear. Important functions like sine functions are tabulated and kept. Eclipses are calculated on the basis of movement of the sun and the moon in the night sky and so on. And planetary locations are calculated because people now want astrological calculations. who can be an astronomer, and there is a syllabus given for astronomer by in Bruhat Samhita by Varahamihira. Okay, and this is what the syllabus looks like. It says a good astronomer should be able to know time division of yuga, year, solstices, seasons. He should know the sutras, the planetary calendar, including retrograde motion of planets and things like that. Savana, which is terrestrial calendar for use on the ground. Understand and calculate solstices, calculate the time of eclipses. Earth's rotation and revolution period should be known. Calculate the latitude and longitude at any given place, starting with Ujjain as the zero latitude. Understand nakshatras and zodiacs and show them in the sky, and teach them to a learned person. Being able to teach them to a learned person is one of the requirements. And one of the most fascinating thing is that astrology is not one of the mentioned subjects. You don't have to be able to predict to become a good astronomer. Astrology is clearly not something that is all that reputed, because Varahamihira doesn't say that you have to be able to predict future based on this kind of astronomical knowledge, but the astronomical knowledge requirement is fairly sophisticated. This is what, for example, the Jain universe looks like. There are 7 levels of heaven, 7 levels of hell, each going one below the other, and the world is, the Mount Meru sits in the middle, and then there are the 7 seas and so on and so forth. But you can see how complex the visualization is. The most beautiful, and I don't think I'm going to speak much time on that simply because I've spoken for too long, but Angkor Wat is something that should be mentioned in Kampuchea or Cambodia if you wish. The most astronomically accurate temple based on Hindu mythology is actually not in India, but it's in Cambodia. I'm going to skip this details except to show you that it is 1 kilometer by 800 meters. Okay, a kilometer by 800 meters. We are talking about gigantic scales. In that, this whole artificial pond has been created. This is artificial. Just a single bridge has been built, and there in the middle sense sits Mount Meru, and then all the gods in the exact directionality. Each stone, each statuette, everything is calculated according to some astronomical mythology. This is what it looks like from the side. This is what the temple itself looks like with this Mount Meru sitting in the middle, and detailed architectural calculations. The shadows of each of these towers is calculated so that if you're standing at a particular position on the bridge, the sunrise at winter solstice and summer solstice and equinox would be along the three stones, and you can see the size of a human being compared to what the door is like. The beautiful architecture. This is the Samudra Manthan stone from Angkor Wat. It's by far the most beautiful place, and various levels have been defined. Planets are over here, and the inner regions are defined, starting with Mount Meru and the rest of the universe. And then, of course, a more modern version of settlement astronomy would go from 5000 BC to about 2500 BC if you are a Harappan. In the Vedic literature, it comes a little later, from about 1500 BC to later periods. If you follow the Vedic literature, astronomy of civilization is 2500 to 1900 BC for Indus civilization, but we have no idea what it looked like. Certainly from 1500 BC to 500 AD, the conventional Vedic religious astronomy would meet this criteria. Technology based astronomy in India comes from 500 AD with Aryabhatta. What I'm trying to say, in just to summarize my last slide, is that it is possible to create a map of the intellectual growth of a civilization or a culture based on astronomy. The growth of astronomy occurs in distinct stages, which are dramatic and which can be quantified. These stages can be considered analogous to phase transition of social evolutions and correspond to each of the social evolutions. And archaeological evidence does not necessarily show all these dramatic changes in phases. So astronomy should be studied, is a statement that I want to make at the end of the day. Thank you very much.